Enlightenment, enlightenment, enlightenment. And I think it's the time. At least we must go towards that step by step. In actual action. First, you have to be honest, you know, it's the biggest problem. To sort of really open that heart out and really break that stagnation. And to really see, I want, what is this life? I want to be liberated. I want to come out of this. And with that, you begin to recognize, you know, your weaknesses and what needs to be done. And to notice your weaknesses, that's a big step. To know, this is my fault, to accept that you made a fault. There's no fault outside. It's a big step. Otherwise, to deceive oneself is like, it's called also Antaraika Dharma by the Buddha. So some things, also this process of confessing and opening up, if some really thing, something bothering oneself. I remember, but you have to have a lot of faith also, certain understanding. I remember once one nun, when I was in Buddha Gaya, this always happened when my meditation is improving. Somebody comes with, I'm like emergency ward somewhere. Searching, so I get this message, someone in big trouble. So I said, they're in hospital. So there are nobody to help also, so I went. It was not a physical problem, it was mostly a mental problem. So, of course, due to some situation, she had done certain mistake. But the problem is, most of them have nobody to tell. Open up, they feel, you know, like you know, whether the person respect you as a person. And so this is a big problem sometimes. Some people just keep it to themselves. So what happened, I told her, don't worry, you just tell me, it's a sound for me, after he is finished for me. Whatever you have, you can just tell. Tell some, till think you're talking to the Dhamma. And I just told her like that. And then, when she told side, I said, this is enough. No need to explain details. Now you must be happy. You just told, put it out. And then other thing, okay, the past is gone, it's nothing. There's no you in the past. I don't think I explained like that. But I think I stole something to some effect. And you continue to go on. And sometimes these things have been the cause for our progress. We don't realize that. They have been the main driving force. We don't know they are the secret blessings. And so life, you know, is coming like an exam. The examination is, I never forget one of my teachers used to tell me, don't worry about the exam. The examination is there to test what you know, not what you don't know. So, same way, life is like just coming to evolve your consciousness. When you get to know, karma is like that, it's funny, nature's drop. How, you know, you're just getting the exact thing, the weakness or the exact thing that you're supposed to get, so that you'll get a chance to correct yourself. And that's why when we really know about it, we don't run away from situations. Yeah, this is one small example today. The Armstrong maybe? Yeah, this is one of the trainings I do with my brother monks. So the greater the, if there's a lot of rain, that's the best day of our Armstrong. This is something very important to not to, I mean, it's not for you all really directly, but especially with my brothers, you learn to accept the reality, the situation. Say maybe somebody's insulting, shouting at you. That's another way. But the other one is a physical one, it could be. So one learns to face that and use the Dhamma. And the Dhamma, you know, is such that when you learn to let go, you're holding on to something. So this is an opportunity for you to train letting go of things. So when if that happens, you find that you gain a lot from that difficult situation. So if you get that, that are challenging, you know, fear about this. Sort of, this is our normal nature, to avoid suffering and to sort of avoid difficult situations, to go to an easy one. Now that this mentality will start to affect in every aspect in our lives, start from small things. So today I'm not going to discuss anything. I've already given some things for this area. I mean, is there any new people today? This gentleman and who else? That's all. All have come yesterday, right? So today, tomorrow, today and tomorrow I'm having here. Then I think in, where is it next?
Thursday.
Liverpool or where?
Thursday, Amaravati.
Amaravati. London, no? Yes. Then after that, maybe until 12th, I'm having a program, 13, 14. The one area, just some taste of it, because some little bit novel also, but you will get to know what is it later. It takes up time. Because all this time, it was something of, you know, only the bana would have, you know, all this. But there is something else going and doing something also. You automatically, it's all this to do meditation, but meditation is automatically happening, it will happen. This is my main goal, where this part of the brain is open, consciousness. If you don't have that, karma will not be coming also. I think there's like a shift in this planet also. Like the people are, who are, there are beings, no doubt. We see a dark side also, but definitely there are beings who, you know, are destined to reach a higher consciousness. So higher kind of even enlightenment, not only higher consciousness, but also that is already going on. So must make use of it. It may be from the old kind of, you know, we don't know, like a cycle, these things come. I told you in Anuradhapura what happened to me. No. I happened to go to one, you know, as a monk, first time when I was going on arms round in Anuradhapura, right, the sacred area. Early morning I went on arms round, and then I went to this where I was looking for a place where I could take the meal quietly and peacefully. So then I found on the way towards the Rwanda from the Sri Mahabodhi Mahasaya, a small opening, and then it was very inviting. I went there and then sat down and took my meals. I was very curious, all these nice, you know, old ruins, but it looks like a very arranged place, you know. I was very curious to know what this place was. Like there was a seat on the side and a stone seat, of course. And so I took my dana and then I went and built that boat, which was, the seat was the dining hall of the monks in the past. I was wondering how I happened to go there. This, sometimes we are meeting like a cycle, it's the same things. Some things we even in this life also we don't remember. But now even this trip I was surprised. In a way I was also in a way surprised. There was one friend of mine as a lay person. I think we last played a badminton game in Run Valley, one hotel, as a boy. We had an unfinished match also, but I remember all, but now with this all this load in his mind, he has forgotten so much. I feel so sorry, you know, with family and all the grey, because I very well remember all the incidents that took place with him. And he was the first who attended the first program in Thames, I think. And I was very happy, I was so happy. So I was just thinking I am contributing back, you know. Say if I live like him, had a family and all that, I would not be, you know, addressing, you know, like now I am really serving these people. I can't tell, there are certain things I noticed that it was now only awakening in them, and it can just go on and you can die, just losing this life. But somebody has to really pave the way, make the path. So anyway, you wanted to ask something? Today is no discourse day. just have a small like a discussion or something, informal. I'm always informal, but make it more informal. You're the original.
No, I'm not going to ask anything.
This is like this, if you have a really pressing question, something really want to, like you have some real problem or something, like to discuss something like that, you can do like that, yes.
Sometimes they maybe need a bit of privacy to
yeah.
So we have arranged, we've got a separate room there, so
okay. It's okay. After a little discussion, some questioning, and yes.
And about Swami Master, can I ask you one question? The Buddhist understanding of non-self.
Sorry, I'm getting old now. My ears are fading, and my ears.
Buddhist understanding of non-self.
Sorry, you must repeat again.
Yeah. So Buddhist understanding.
Buddhist understanding. Okay. Right.
Of non-self. Because I'll tell you a little story, because I'm by trade, I'm a doctor.
Right.
I'm an anesthesiologist.
Okay.
So the consciousness and unconsciousness.
But I like this stuff, yeah.
Very good. It's very familiar to me.
Uh-huh.
And so when, in our trade, we put people to sleep by giving a very strong medication, by administrating a strong
okay.
medication.
Look, you mean local, they call it what is that?
The general, if you give a general anesthetic to put them to sleep and then you get the effect when the subsides, the medication is waking up after some time. The first things to go is very higher functions. As human beings, I think we have a very high function of judgment, thinking, the situation awareness and all that. So try to understand a little bit of beyond the physiology and whatever you learn a little bit further. Thank you. A little bit further. Sometimes I think we are like a huge computer. So we can process a lot of things. We can get a lot of data from outside. So we are making ourselves to understand the world. And it's like existing a new computer, like new program. When you pull the plug of that computer, everything will go. Is this something too far from Buddhism, my understanding of non-self? Or could you please shine a light on this topic?
Yeah, it's very interesting for me also. Now, normally I explain in regarding very interesting how the Buddha has made a certain. Have you ever gone through the YouTube what I have spoken before? No?
Yes, yes.
Or the animal reptilian brain and
yes, yes,
this thing.
Yes.
I'm also very interested, you know, because it really gave me also. I never decided to talk on that topic. Actually, I want to talk more of the non-self nature of consciousness and all that. But according to what I found, the audience, when I came to public in 2012, this idea clearly came that people are sort of, you know, draining energy, how this mental energy is lost and how to preserve it to get that vision, that part of the brain open. Because now in the Buddha's teaching, it shows you how that particular part of the brain, you know, there is a special level of, you could say, consciousness, awareness to be awakened to get this vision. As long as you don't have that, you know, we are using the five senses mostly. So, let me get warmed up because I'm not in a thinking mood, okay? I'm like in my gym, in a different type of gym, all the day, whole day, and then, what I live.
I just want the simplest terms, that's really what it is.
Okay, no. But I'd like to get your idea properly. So normally when you put into anesthesia and then come out, you find these things working first, or what is it?
What I found is the judgment, thinking, awareness, that kind of higher functions
okay,
will disappear.
Uh, when you put into an exam,
yes, first very stages, okay. But for the latter stages, probably all the other functions like breathing in and out, those things probably might disappear, and the heart might stop if you go a little bit further. But I always, I have a duty of care to my patients, so this is for GMC. I'm always conscious about these things. But I try to understand a little bit beyond the physiology, beyond the normal knowledge. So it is like we are like existing big computers who actually try to understand the world and try to understand the things by, as you said, using the vision and hearing and all these things. But end of the day, that's kind of a myth.
I have heard that in the scientific world, consciousness is the least understood thing.
That's right.
And it is called the hard question, right?
That's right.
I'm coming to your terms, right? So it's very true, because I understand how can you, because if you try to understand from the vessel what supports, which the thing that is supported only by that vessel, you're never going to find it. Of course, you have a very good, you know, long time projects going on, your life will continue as a research person, but in the East, it was quite, they were quite close many times to know this consciousness as something separate from the body. Something is only using the body for it to be supported, but it's entirely different. I mean, it has no, you can't sort of make out of some material thing consciousness. And you can never make consciousness, you know, like independent, other than without a body. I mean, it's not understood also, how can you? And so this consciousness, one must know that even a body, idea of body also doesn't come without any idea of consciousness, without the rising of consciousness. Do you understand that point?
Yes.
Even the very idea of there's a body, or even this very recognition of any kind, without the mental factors of feeling, perception, and you know, these are the factors of consciousness. Now, this is explained by the Buddha, not by researching. With his enlightenment, he saw the factors in the in a moment of consciousness. Whenever there is any, he explains like with eye and object, you have immediately the eye consciousness, nose and this thing. You have a nose, tongue, and so they are with each, and they are one time at a time. It arises in only once. You can't have eye, tongue together. Do you get that point?
Yes.
So it's, you can't sort of tell it is here somewhere like that. Because we normally, of course, but for the practical purpose, you know, it's very, our purpose is to really not to get frightened by consciousness. Frightened means normally we see this world as so real, that is what we could become conscious of. And that has caused so much suffering, so much distress. Even the worry of dying also is connected with that. If you had completely, you know, that, you know, free from all these experiences and memories and all that, I mean, you would be at peace. You may enjoy everything, but more you enjoy, then the moment of death comes. When you know you have to leave these things, you don't have to think of that reality, even. It creates so much, you know, so much worry. I mean, before death even, you will even come closer to death. You will die before that so many times. So, the functioning of consciousness is very, what you told about analyzing and all that, that we call normally the perception part of, you know, more in the consciousness. And it is said now, actually the five senses, the five sense organs, the impressions that come, it is received by the mind. That's it. And I hope I can take you in my journey, just because these things, sometimes it also they are like you see something like clinically dead, you know, because we don't know the reach of or the levels of being conscious. Even we say coma and all that. And in that state also, from what you observe from external clinically, you know, they say this something, you see, where you don't have, you can't have a use a sensual observation to notice it. But it go beyond sensual. Of course, if you have the mind, the ability to be aware of the mind of another, then that will you know, show that it's still functioning. And but it can't respond. And we can't notice any responses. So, because it's so fine, you know, you can't observe it from a gross thing. It can be known only from an equally fine instrument. So it is consciousness itself, you can know consciousness. I will tell you in slow motion normally how it is, but more you explain, it shows you have not understood this. This is how this topic works. But for your general sort of, you know, liking of this modern day, how it, this thing, it's just a small explanation, it helps in a certain way. So normally, the Buddha says, you know, we have ear and the, like an object. And when these are just material part, whether it's a wave or something, you know, it comes in sound waves. So they are both a material part of it. And with that there is suddenly what it says like something happen. That is a kind of a, that's consciousness. And with that consciousness, with the attention of it, says there's a contact. So there's some sensation goes. So they are simultaneously happening. It's not something you can separate in a moment of consciousness, this slow, like taking slow motion. And there's something like a sensation. And there's something in the, there's another factor in the consciousness. Next, it sort of measures that sensation, sort of judges it, measures it. This kind of measuring nature is called perception. Either it perceives it as pleasant or unpleasant or neutral. In every moment, this is happening. When it is perceived as pleasant, there is another part which happens, reaction. It greed. Which is unpleasant, reaction with hate. And it's neutral, reaction with delusion. So this reaction is called sankara. The term, this is mental formation, how it is this thing. So this is happening constantly with each sense. Whenever you are, this is engaged. So, that's why we are now what in meditation, what we are doing is we are changing the way the knowledge part, the vision part is in perception. So we have now normally the other perception is so illusionary, you know. It is not, so we purify that perception. This meditation is nothing but purifying what we perceive. Now perception is like an illusion. So now you have a perception of the illusion. This is the only right perception we could have. So we replace it by, you know, seeing plainly what is going on, taking away the fantasy and, you know, the all kind of, and that's where this kind, that special knowledge, now there are so many ways of knowing reality or, you know, even removing fantasy. But this has a very specific one, which, another one that we can know is the type of knowledge we get about something, which creates, if you, the test of whether you got that particular knowledge is how much you let go. That is the this particular. Now we have all types of knowledge also we can get with perception. But the Buddha, what he wants, because he saw the cause of suffering is, you know, desire. So because we see things wrongly, we get desire. So when you see it rightly, correctly, you know, that to get that correct vision which removes the desire, that's what he tries to activate. So now even scientists, they see this flux and things like that, you know, there are so many types. But that doesn't make them leave their wife and children and go and become a contemplative somewhere. It doesn't happen. So this one, which if you have it, that will, I mean, even you might not leave, but your tremendous detachment will set in. And you'll be at peace with that. Not that it makes you frightened or put you into, no. You become really, you know, solid, stable with that. So it's like holding a snake, I always tell. And you look at, you're holding a string. And you look into it and it's a snake. There's no question of letting go. So now even in our teachings, you know, we have, now even my brother monks many times ask me, Bhante, you talk about this impermanence and all that. Is there a particular type of impermanence? Yes. Because there's a type of vision which makes you detach. So even if you think in a certain way of impermanence and it makes you let go, that is in the right direction. But you must not conclude, this is the, when you continue it, you will have different degrees of that kind of vision, perception, Dhamma perception, spiritual perception. So only in the end, only when those perceptions you let go, you see it, you know, you become like an observer of this. Observer means you use it only, you know the purpose that it is only for, but you don't identify with it. Because even that you see that is not a self in it. But that is the beauty of it. I would recommend, like, I have certain experience of this in to the Chachakka Sutta. The thing is, you know, those, but when you have to think, even the Buddhahood or any knowledge you get of liberation, of which liberates you, a knowledge that liberates you is also not you. Because, not you, because it is something just arising out of conditions. Because you thought a certain way, that was the cause for it to arise. And then it has to be sustained. And with that knowledge, you get an idea. You know, this is like so you feel the purity of the Buddha, where there's no, it's completely the idea of ego, of selfhood, is understood. How it arises, how it's formed, and is completely annihilated. And in that situation, you know, the purity of the person is not a trace of self-interest or ego, even spiritually self-interest. Now sometimes you may cut the body of a saint, but if you cut his ideas, he will get upset. you can whip the body, but if you whip their ideas, you might argue with me something, for example, you can check. Now I will be okay with everything, but if you argue with a certain view of mine, and so on, but in this one, you remove all views. That is the view that remove all views. You see the, you use it for some purpose, but you know its limitation and you know its place. So that's why that any kind of attachment, even subtler ones to spiritual ones, also finally is removed. This is like completely, this is the purpose where you are not in bondages outside nor inside. And even regarding consciousness, you know, you can also see it like this, like you, a dog looking into a well. Now, there are so many ways, many explain this, but this is not the real picture, even the one I told now, the reaction and all that. But these are also faulty, you know. You have to keep it in a fluid form. If you take it as this, if you try to verbally or intellectually get the idea of consciousness, you will not, but you have to get some material to hang on to. Take it like that, but if you purify and keep practicing, you'll find you one day get to know what it is exactly. Because Buddha directs you. When you see those, you want to say something?
Yeah, yes. I can understand. You can make something out of something, but make something out of nothing. It's I think probably you have vegetarian.
Yeah, something about nothing. You can't do it with something. That is true. So you have to go to nothing to know it. And you have to meditate in this subject to really, it's not something research, it can be known. This is someone, if they properly practice or use the proper thinking and the type of purification that is necessary for the brain to function more efficiently, this is more important. That is one way I have to use that completely. I mean, this is how I. The way I came to the Dhamma was really in an accidental way. I was having a search for this. Because relativity that struck me, you know, the time dilation, the effect, relativistic effect of, and then I was going through my mother's, you know, there were some of the books in South Africa, actually. and regarding, you know, the planes of other existence, the time, like 1,000 years on Earth is the cosmology, you know, Buddha, how he has explained, and they just suddenly fit in. And so because I was open-minded and I just want to, I found school and university everywhere was not, you know, giving me the, because my answer, I was looking for answers finally, not something. So this, I was very much, there's a big drive inside me. And then I came across this, and then I used it also. I felt connected to those worlds through this, and predicted those days that, you know, I was then studying those exam papers and what I have to, I have told this story a long time, many times. And that gave me a kind of an idea in which direction, you know, like to think. But based on that, I had another one, which was, you know, like I, that was something really, something what maybe I was searching for, like this vanity of all these things. You can say about it, but as I told you, it will make you leave your wife, there's no question. Because many ask me one thing, once thing, I think Berlin, they were asking me, why are you a monk? I was just saying, why are you not a monk? This question come to me, because this is like, you know, you're, when you see, if you're really seeing what's going on, what is ahead, because we are living in an intoxicated state of mind, we don't actually really perceive the reality that's ahead of us. If you do, we will, you know, have so become so uneasy about it. So our normally, we are either partly intoxicated, and then we are involved with the searching for it also, but not touched by that. So, but we, in the process of certain purity and enjoying meditation, this is what I start with. First you have to do that, and there will be glimpses of it. So you must see the material benefit side of meditation also. It's not something separate, you know, you will have less and less a long face in your daily life. You see the benefit coming, the inner certain joy should increase, and you will be more harmonious around your, you know, surroundings. And you'll be able to face any kind of situation which is challenging, which more, you could say, you know, fearlessness and fortitude. So this, when you see this, then you take that as happiness, not that some fleeting, certain, you know, enjoyment. When that is happening more and more, there are chances, because you begin to taste the happiness of purity, not the corruption. And then the pure side of the mind. Then there's chance of the wisdom part of the brain to function more. Because they have to be enhanced. This is, I think, a well-known small part of our brain is working, right? Is it? I don't know. I am also very interested in, I don't know how to relate to, I find very interesting. It relates to, even near death, some people facing near death, you must be close to them, right?
Yes. The part of, it is called the reincarnation, get the light back.
Yes.
I came across quite a bit. Yes.
And when they are losing the light, have you heard them saying something or sort of really wanting something or telling something? Mostly, have you noticed that?
Not really telling something. Sometimes I don't know. Some people call it like last ditch reflex. So they probably throw it everything to sustain their lives, so we can see the glimpse of, yes, you can see the glimpse of eyes, the pupil will dilate, your heart rate will rise, that kind of physical feeling.
Right.
It's very difficult to understand which point is the death thing. It might be not a point, it might be a kind of a journey from A to B. I exactly don't know. It might be somewhere in between A and B.
Yeah.
Can't tell. This is the point. I don't know. My knowledge is
sometimes you might be burying people who are alive also.
Hope I haven't. Hope I haven't.
Occasions where sleep lighters happen.
Yes. It could be, but. As you said, it's very difficult to understand which point is that.
Physically, it's difficult because, you know, very small part of the brain could be used for the functioning of the consciousness. So not even if it damaged so many, because sometimes you could, even at a higher state of meditation, very finer parts of it is working. The way I would understand is that very fine, you can have very little of your body and you can live.
That's right. I had some experience. We told patient that had gone long time ago, was on supportive ventilator, but tried to write a death certificate and tried to even plan for an organ retrieval. So, but after a few days, he started waking up.
Okay.
That was a really, really alarming sign for me. It's a big eye opener. That's quite few things happen like that. So he probably changed little parameters here and there, and then we managed to wake him up after some time. Sometimes it's frightening, but that's my experience. We can't tell exactly which way his brain sees us.
So, doctor, do you have plans for the future? Any kind of aspiration or plan?
I try to understand what's really happening beyond the physiology. What really happened? Probably we can't understand by the experiments.
Yeah, definitely. I don't think so. If you want to not to get an answer, you can go to the experiments because you have to see it wisely. You know that consciousness is something, or even the brain. The brain is the organ which supports. It's an organ. You know, like, I mean, do you agree with that? I don't know.
Yeah.
I also like to polish my. It's very interesting for me. It's an organ, right?
My understanding is like a big melting pot. Because all these youngsters, they are probably very computer literate. So if I tell you their language, it's like a hardware and software.
Okay.
You have a big hardware, and there are a lot of things, a lot of synapses, a lot of enzymes are happening, and proteins are forming and they're destroying at the same time. The memory, a lot of things probably happening there. So we can alter here and there something. That's what we do in our job. So we do strong, we administer strong medication, probably we try to suppress some part of the brain and then activate some part of the brain. So that's what we try. That it is, I think it's very superficial, we try to do it. So it's like a melting pot. So at the end of the day, it's like a hardware and software. So if the hardware goes, software can't run. If the software goes, hardware can't run. Something like that. That is my very primitive understanding of that.
No, it is interesting. As a surgeon and a doctor, I'm sure, you know, if you have that as long as you don't, I mean, this is also like my whole family was like doctors, you know, my grandfather and with cancer and all that in Sri Lanka long years ago, and even now some of them. So, but he used to accompany, I think he has written, like, being a doctor is like the calling, he says. He used to write, though he was very upset with his students, you know, who they were going to commercial, this thing. And I remember he saw a small this thing, but it's a calling and it's an art, it's not a business, something like that. He wrote some words, I can't remember. And yeah, because you have that heart, but this to search for something beyond, it has to come from a special drive. Unless you're so restless about not getting answers for life, if you have that urge only, and if you're just satisfied with that, means just why worry about these questions, then this will never be answered. So that one has that drive, definitely, one will. So I can see when some of the now new. You know, people that you are, if you guys make more time and make bring meditation into one's daily routine life. I mean, yesterday and the day before I explained, not before once, because yesterday was a very nice one. I was going more into Nibbana a little bit. And if after a long time, this two, three, this thing, I was explaining more about what was really. So I don't know why it just started to come. Maybe this crowd is special a bit. I love it naturally to come, and I was also happy, I was also refreshed. Always sticking to, you know, telling about the addictions and all this. But because there's another issue, we are thinking of higher things, and this is my another main job to graphically show where the energy is lost mentally and how to show, you know, very clearly when you get purification and then more how the brain areas are open. I explained about this also, where ojas, I mixed with some ideas of Ayurveda also, where it does happen, so how they just try to paint it with another this thing. So when it opens up certain areas, how you can see the mood also changing, and especially the energy in the brain, mainly by the pressures mostly. If the stronger the pressure, it is more, and then the fluidity goes away. This is the way I explain. I like to get this thing from you. It's very so you have to, if it becomes very dry and karaveda, I know, okay. So not to allow that to happen. Where that you pump in, especially the ojas is called, which it normally deposits in the areas which are very fine, they start to function. And when that happens mostly, then your meditation, because of meditation, calm level, something has to be formed. When the excitement is there, some else, like adrenaline and all this. The opposite way, something also has to form. You know? So there's that finer one, which is normally Hindu or yogic cooked up, they know ojas. That is supposed to go to the brain and deposit in certain areas of the brain and open the unopened parts of the brain. And when that happens, it actually makes you automatically meditate again or do those things, analyzing and calming down or any of these positive functions that happens then automatically. So more of this happening forms in your body also. The aura becomes clear. In other words, you become handsome or more nice. Now the shine in the cheeks and forehead will come. So this, not to lose that. So that then people get an idea of the tangible. Otherwise, you know, this is not something to keep in theory. You will see that even physically, then you're forming your body more towards liberating yourself. And even stories talking the animal nature, you know, the reptilian brain actually. So nice. The MRI scan, some of the things, has been very interesting, doctor. It was very, especially, I mean, I hope you go through my, how I tell, actually, they have found that even sexual activity, when it comes to a certain peak level, how the entire reptilian brain take over the entire brain, isn't it? I don't know. I mean, it is completely functioning. That means, in other words, the part of thinking and what you're telling, that part gets shut down. It's correct, right? Medical knowledge, I know. So that is very interesting. Very interesting because Buddha put at that level grave offense in the Vinaya. Now, for me, it was really to see how the Buddha knew the levels of how much damaging what part, and he sort of categorized it according to that severity. And that makes you really that he gave it for us as a protection. That this is like your, you know, green light. Don't, you know, go beyond this, it is going to damage. And he put ways of purification. These things are happening common as in the lay community today. No one, these levels of indulgence. So if that is not addressed, how this realization will be? If you can't tell, if we don't tell where we are in the well, it with depth, you know, how are we going to rescue? You'll ask Bana everywhere, no, I mean here and there, but it's just, this has been my main this thing for some years now. So, but yesterday, a few days back, also other programs, this was coming up more now, which I want to touch regarding that one, and also dopamine. How it is this thing with the addiction, of course, and about computer games, doctor, have you the addictive, you know, that computer games, and that when you're playing like that, the dopamine level, one place research that equal to heroin.
That's right.
So this, I hope I can speak to you more. I want to get, because I want to relate to the people, you know, really, you know, what is happening, not to blindly follow this, just to know the real part, what is going on. So this is with computer games. I don't know what other functions, texting, I have no idea. I'm not using this this type of, I only know how to use YouTube, and I get some information from that, and I don't want to learn anything further, because if we touch those things, we will never have got what we have got already. If you have too much knowledge, and those days in the forest, we had only a lamp and kerosene lamp, and then this book slowly, just a page or so of suttas, and that we were more focused on getting a vision of it. So that is different. You have to, if you have a lot of knowledge also, that blocks that particular stillness of mind and getting intuitively. Dopamine. Endorphins also positive, no? Endorphins? And the runners, yes. But is addictive?
Yes, no. It has. I hope I'm not.
Later, we come to them. They have been anxious. Okay. Yeah, we'll talk about it later, right? I can't be selfish also, right? Anyone else something, or you want to tell your something personal things you like to? I mean, I don't do this very much. I have told some places where, but this is like quite a crowd of people who want to. It's okay, you can, if you are not in a hurry.
Swami Nuhan sir, yesterday you were sort of trying to demonstrate how to use the original scriptures, words of Buddha, to contemplate and try to get this vision of what he was trying to actually mean through these words.
Slowly.
So I don't know whether this is the right time for you to sort of teach us some of this, demonstrate and give us a
glimpse. Yeah, I'd like to do it. I'm also a little bit neglected these things for some years, going to Himalayas and all these different type of practice, but I have, these are the things that are driving me from deep within me, which I was started as the first initial thing in South Africa. Then when I got the suttas from my teacher, because you see that he's alive still in those words. And but only thing, how to, now that's why now we read suttas, get knowledge, but we have not known how to meditate on it. This is what we learned, you see. The problem is, the thing is to separate these suttas, you know, like you have the past where he talks about, say, even consciousness. He explains a nice part. I recommend this book. I don't want to wear glasses but can't help it. because I thought I should not repair my body in any form. This is what we have learned, to give up this body and to become a part of it. But when I need to read this, not only this, some things, so this is the instrument to be used. Because I thought finally this banner will be this banner. If one can demonstrate, that's the sign, the only sign of what you really experience within you, that you are in it, not in this body. So excuse me, I have to use this. This one I found really interesting. Interesting is this whole thing. I recommend this word of the Buddha by Jnanatiloka. This is what made me my teacher, from yogi to follow the, because sometimes the pressure and all this particular, now he was enjoying already the samadhi as a young boy. My life, and who inspired me, the master, my teacher, we had similar background, I feel, in some form. So he was first introduced to Bhagavad Gita when he was in Hamburg, and then later on he left to India to work. And there he was also in Sri Lanka. And during the Second World War, he was, you know, put into intern camp. And there he was really disillusioned, because first, he used his meditation of samadhi. He was a director in the company, Freudenberg or something. And there, he used the meditation to take right decisions. And then he built up certain, you know, Kurudvata Tamai Indalatiyane, my teacher that time, he had a job. And then suddenly, all this, everything fell apart. Like, he came to zero. Everything confiscated. As a prisoner of war, not war, a prisoner interned there, it allowed them to Dehradun in North India. Where then when he was there, he saw these Buddhist monks, Jnana Tiloka Pante, and then he went and met them, of course, and then they gave him this book, which is taken from original sutras and put under Four Noble Truths. But taken nice, very interesting, it's very, very structured book for a beginner and to an end, to the end. So here you have certain areas, so when he went, because that idea of how to watch and to become enlightened, to know, to get wisdom, that was immediately got from this, not saying a feeling or kind of a plain observing things. So this like completed his kind of search within him. So this one, I also keep it now, he used to give us to read through this to get a structure, theoretical idea always when we start our practice. Now there are certain places, it's enough to even become enlightened from that. Those days when they were cutting the hair, they became enlightened. There's not something wrong with the word, so it's something wrong with our level of tranquility, purity. So you must know this, you know, how it happened those days and why it's not happening in us. There's something wrong, you know, where our lifestyle, how we walk, how we drive the car, I explain these things. Where you're not doing it in a way that makes you peaceful and tranquil. So these are practical, they have to be done. This, because this knowledge is lost in this part of the world. They take us as some like a robot, you know, or this kind of education system. So it leaves aside kind of well-being of mental peace. It has no idea of peace, you know. That there is we leave that aside and we just go to the sort of see things, material and utility of things, and you know, give preference to that, and just we don't think, you know, that the happiness is. That's what we get from our, you know, in Asia. So there, but Asia also now not following that. They're going for traditions and pujas, and you know, they have, of course, it gets corrupted when it is always interpreted by unenlightened communities of spiritual people. They will be making it to their idea. So then you lose the bearing. So normally, now in my case, I see like a revolution, you know, because we are not coming from any, going against now, did I give you Panchasila? So I'm going straight to the subject. So in Sri Lanka, but nobody is telling anything now because, of course, some good karma is behind me. And, but of course I see, this is like a messenger in a way. Quickly, this is the last hour. It's chance who can get out of it. That's how I see. So this originally, when you go to the original words and learn to apply them, it's very simple. You should not try to squeeze the understanding also. You should, when you understand, you put the other things, you should not relate it to what are the explanation in the past. So it's easy if someone like very small or who has not studied at all, even the Dhamma or any subject is easy to teach. Even other meditation methods. Because that thinking enters this and this plane. If someone taught you to read the map originally, that would have been good. But there are many who explain this map a lot. Now, who is explaining means the way I understand is that they have not really understood this. Because if they understood, they would directly tell you to read the manual directly. They would not try to explain it. That means they are also researching still. I'm giving some points, but it might be a bit revolution, you know. I mean, not revolution, it might, but this is the way I see. So that explanation will change after a few months, few years, because it's a constant, they are in the process of research. So if someone really experienced, you tell him to read again, go through this, purify, and he'll be patient. His Bana will not be very interesting. but you know, that's the. So this is the one yardstick is at least the behavior. You know, that's not the talking period, the time of your other times, how you behave, how much hate and greed is. At least you know two things you can see in a person. You can't read the mind and you should not judge also because it gets reflected from what we are within us. But at least, you know, we know someone got angry when you have, the word comes out, little spike. Or something like that. And you can see the expression of the body also. So there is no, you can't hide. So at least this must not be present in someone who you'd like to follow. You understand? Because if you are going to follow someone who can't even manage to do this, who, I mean, then leave alone. So you can have an entertainment, but always is good if someone is really honest, you know, they would make you independent with the master himself. So I always stress that, okay, YouTube, I'm telling just to cut short my explanation, but I would not recommend someone to go through the YouTube of me and getting attached to me. It's completely opposite to my main mission. If they can direct themselves back to the master, the original teaching, so have it in your near your bedside and just read a page or so and a little bit meditate. Read a page. And when you feel your mind is running somewhere, read a bit. So you're influenced by it. The thing is, I feel a little bit guilty also telling you like telling any of you like this. How many of you you have to go far away, anyone? Or are you going to stay in this vicinity? It's night time, no? Quickly. So we'll go quickly, okay? We'll just maybe do one slowly. So I always say, so now the other thing is how to relate to your present moment. This is most important. You don't sort of read something and get an idea, you try to apply it to your present condition. So normally, one step is always to how to get the body relaxed. It's very important. So I show some things, sometimes how to find whether you're relaxed, at least the body. And then you learn to pay attention to what's going on immediately. That means you try to hear what, at least hear the sounds, or feel the pressure of your seated to your back, or so you get a, you learn to sort of bring your attention to the moment. And this is something should not be done only in meditation. If you are doing this when you are driving, I say how the seat, to feel the seat and this. So these are your general routine practice. And how to cut away from this, you know, like what you are seeing now, to not to get the impressions which, you know, like I explained, you know, the sense control, especially the eyes and all that, like when I see you, or the audience here, I can see that. But when I'm looking like this, I'm not focused. That unfocus is called Indriya Samurasiya. When I see that what is attractive or what is something negative, that I learn to screen. So that the mind, the monkey mind will be less. Now say you're crossing a road, you see a vehicle passing, but you don't see who is in the vehicle. Like that you learn to separate. So this is a daily practice if you want to really improve in your meditation. You must, it's have to be trained. And after that, learning to relax and to pay attention to what is immediately felt. If you're holding the steering wheel, now you know, some who are sort of taking me, the organizers, sometimes they feel like, oh, but they might be lost immediately, so they want to ask everything while they're driving. So slowly, one gentleman, I remember, he was, and he's having breathing problems, so many problems he's having, diseases, I think. And suddenly I told, you know, my friend, why don't you feel how you are holding the steering wheel? I said, you can practice now, and then just feel the seat touching your back. And because he was good driving like this, right? I said, like the reclining chair you have in, at home, sometimes in Sri Lanka we have this reclining Hansiputra, reclining chair. Now because his seat was back, but he was holding the, so I told him, well, you can recline, like relax in a holiday. Don't worry whether you're going to take Bante on time or not. And just feel the seat. And when he sat down, you know, I think he has never experienced this certain mental peace, which is so simple and so cheap and so, but it's, I mean, these are the things where you have to, so he then started, then he stopped talking. He was enjoying, just keeping attention to the present moment. He was first time enjoying, I think. And then he was saying, Bhante, I wish you were always with me, you know, to remind. I said, well, this is something you don't forget. I mean, yesterday I spoke to you all, you know, but you forgot all these points. I mean, I have spoken in that different program, And then this simple thing, this because I'm also concerned that you must, is my life, my it's also. It's not intellectually abstract way of thinking about it. It's something I know also. And then I'm in it, and we are going in that path. And someone who really wants to make a practical change or go into this Dhamma, may be helpful meeting this meeting. So anyway, I was so happy. Because this is the second after Australia, this happened with the, because Australia touched the person's head and he got an idea, he was holding it slowly. So this one learns to, even my uncle, you know, he was taking me in Navaloka one time, and so I always teach them this, but they just rush to do their work. So they had to go after Himalayas, they build that special, that machine, I don't know, you know, the heart, how it's working. So he actually told me, you can for 5 years, don't worry about in the Himalayas, if you do this test. So I thought, I didn't want to go into this big test. But when he told me like that, I did go. And on when we were walking from, you know, he was personally taking me to all these other sections, go and I know what, this and that. This, then he was rushing. I was thinking, all this time I have told them, while working, now this is my main mission, while working how to bring the meditation. That meditation is not something separate from your work. I don't know how today was it, how was it? Is it better? You're getting some, that behind some peace while doing the work? Did you experience that? Did you try? I hope that, because this is important. This is my main thing, you know, now you're not going to, you're going to enjoy some, that tranquility is within you, you'll never tap that. The work is not, we think a lot of work has disturbed this, no. That part of the brain has not been opened or functioning. Now when it's open, you find even how much work, you're not going to leave that mental stressless mind. Is it the right English? I don't know, stressless, this new vocabulary. Just coming to my mouth. This is something I hope this can be a gift I'm giving you all, if I'm, so that you know that whether you're in England is not the problem. It's not that you have a lot of work is the problem. It is that you are not mastering that certain technique, of course. You have to, you know, and you are not seeing so simple also, not complicated. You learn to first not to think much and just focus on what you're feeling and increasing your ability to pay attention to the moment. So when you do that, then the mind becomes, you don't bring in the anithya or anything, no, first don't do that. leave everything. Just try to increase that ability to sustain the immediate contacts you are going through, and just see how that mind level, contacting the energy part of your brain, and then the energy starts to ooze out. From then you feel the tranquil, and you know this, allow that, is very important. And the planning, okay, you plan something, but you bring back the attention. Doesn't mean you keep on planning, becomes your always occupation. And that's going to disrupt the plan, because when you reach those stages, you'll be so tired. And then you'll not be efficient to perform properly. But when you stay in the prasam moment, in those stages, like that you learn to make the mind, you know, slowly work at its optimum. And then your meditation, when you sit down and you get time, it all starts to work much better. And while you're going also, you can read a bit. It's okay. You can do this. Then just paying attention to the sounds, and then having, just looking at yourself like from outside. That you have to visualize how you are dressed, you know, like I'm in my case, robes, you know, maybe shirts, t-shirts, jackets or whatever, how you are dressed. It's important. Normally, you don't need to even close your eyes, just have a mental picture. And even if you remain seated in your bed, just relax in your bed. It's good, because when you go into a deeper kind of not paying attention to the outside world, also you can't contemplate too much. When you are so focused outside, you are so restless, and your mind is, you know, in a state of, then also you can't contemplate. So you have to get that middle, this thing. In my case, in my personal meditation, actually, I had no any very strong or great experiences while I was seated meditation. Doing always it was when I was walking. in the nature, when I was a young boy, the first one it took place, and then it was because you are not in a deep, no, there, like outside. There it can trigger that particular insight of self-realization. Because more into deeper, you stop thinking very much. But this happens to me now, because for the programs, I'm doing a little bit of that to come. But I wish I'm not doing that much because I like to, but it's going to help. Because stronger the concentration of peacefulness in the mind, I don't want to more use the word concentration. So it's another nice word that just effect of it. That can trigger because the mind is pure from the reptilian brain functioning, in other words, and the neuralness is like a water without trying to dye. Sensual desires compared to dye. All the dye is put into the water. And bubbling water is like anger, irritation, it weakens all this. So, and what it is, muddy water is, you know, with like sloth and top or sleepiness top. It's very interesting, you can call the reptilian brain, whatever function is happening anytime in the reptilian brain is functioning, it's a hindrance. So when it is shut down, actually, that's the moment of samadhi. Only moment that it will be shut down, where you don't have even thoughts of the outside world. Now, even if you are thinking or you are noticing thoughts also coming, you are not in samadhi yet. You are still, maybe that will help you to slow or lessen the thoughts. But that's why when you have a strong devotion or in the Buddha Ramana Piti or some, you know, that is when metta also, there you will like enter, you could say, a heated room from cold. You could feel the piti. Actually, it's nice to take it the other way around. Because like in a hot place, you come to air conditioned room. So those affects the feelings when you enter that stillness is piti, bliss, piti, sukha, ekagrata, first dhyana. So when you are that, you are tranquilized, you know, you are so self-sustained and happy, self-contained. You are sort of that blissful. So there, I'm sure, reptilian brain is just one stage where the reptilian brain is completely shut down. So that is a moment where you can analyze this. The Buddha's analyzing and contemplation really works in that state of mind. The reason we contemplate in other states of mind where the mind is working is always not giving the desired effect of intuitive knowledge. You get some intellectual clarity and all that, but it's not life changing. Transforming your character, your behavior. That means, you know, that will stop all that sort of agitated activity in the mind from a root level. Because we have also the consciousness, when it arises, we have the latent tendency level and the latent tendency level is the main thing. So normally when you have the deeper insight becomes latent. Then it's a natural meditation. Your life has a permanent effect. Even when you are not sort of so-called meditating, in your daily movements of life, it's the tranquility will show. You will enjoy that peacefulness permanently. Because the certain that germ inside you of your defilements are rooted out to a certain extent. It's like a rotten tooth, you know, like rather than repairing it, you have sort of taken it out completely. But you have other teeth, maybe. So one by one you have to take out and become teethless, you know. So without any those unsaid latent things of getting angry, getting greedy. Otherwise, before that is always controlling process. You have a controlling this thing. So you don't want to go on controlling. That's why we make sure we are humble enough in our daily life. Walking also, we check whether we are doing it peacefulness. So we start early morning, when we have, you know, start the day with that, you know, sort of putting the purity and tranquility into you and then touching the work. You place value to that. If you feel tired when you are doing work, you have done the wrong way. If you feel, you know, when you are doing it, it should make you, you know, you must enjoy it. Because you are not enjoying from the work, you are enjoying from the tranquility of the mind. You understand? And normally we learn to enjoy the work when the work is finished. Then we have holiday. But we already learned to have our permanent holiday. Keeping that peace of mind. And even if rough people come, it's okay. It's an external thing. You're not tied too much with it. If the weather is bad, no problem. Yeah, now whenever some people were taking me, I was actually expecting British weather supposed to be always raining and gloomy and all that. That's what I heard. But from the day I came, I mean, the place where I went, it was sunny and all that. So I think my old friend, yeah, the guy who was taking me, he was like, oh, Monday, this is a sunny day. I didn't want to bring my immediate, you know, knowledge about what is going on. I want to share. So I want to tell, now then we are going the next day. It was dark and rainy. So I said, today is also a sunny day, isn't it? This is how you have your inner sun. You are not dependent, just the sensual. If you enjoy the sunny day, you will have to enjoy the rainy day. You are not there to enjoy it, to experience it. But if you don't enjoy the sunny day, there is something more peaceful of letting go of all these perceptions. And that inner, this thing is far, far more beautiful. That scenery is far, far more, you know, the experience of inner samadhi. It is more peaceful. When the mind has quenched of his desires to a certain extent, that you will experience this contentment and inner fulfillment. So these are not nibbana, but towards it helps you. If you're in such tranquil state only, there can be those spark knowledge of even that does something. You will let go even that. You let go even the inner beauties. Then you are left with the highest beauty. It's wisdom, just wisdom. That is beyond feelings. It's something. That's why it needs, this is a chance we should actually focus when we still have strength of mind to come make it a realization in us. That's why in those days when the hair was cut or some simple thing that triggered that particular scene, so that universal truth of the purpose. Things are going to happen. So we do small exercise how we will read, how we do it, okay? Just quickly we do, otherwise, because he's asking me, what shall we do? Are we meeting tomorrow, no? Are we tomorrow signing, or how is it? Tomorrow rest, or how? Tomorrow is digestion day, right? Today also, but your stomach might be filled. Tomorrow we meet like this?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Slowly now you're getting addicted to it. It was only yesterday program, not yesterday before. Yesterday was the last. Today is like extra. You all wanted retreat, I think you were thinking like that, but you know, at this stage maybe. I'm also tempted, I think you all are quite earnest about, but don't think you're missing on anything. I have given all the main, kind of tools and the Satman and all that, you know, I am walking meditation. There's one clip of day retreat in Australia. This I have not come, I hope maybe in the future. It's not one day, I need like 10 days or there were, you know, 12 days. There are some things which my teacher, but I have given part of it. If you're really sincere, even if you ever never meet me, you should be able to go with that. You have the master here. So, but only thing how to contemplate that, you know, I have told little bit at the end of the programs. Like, you know, telling in Pali and watching yourself through that, relating it to you. Say, for example, yesterday somebody scolded you or something, you have a memory. You must remember that moment was a moment of consciousness coming. It was the factors in the consciousness. Of feeling, perception, and recognizing, and sort of recognizing it as someone scolded me. But those parts, when you look at it in terms of parts taking place, and you remind yourself, Buddha says that these past perceptions, feelings, they arose to pass away. Then you must visualize that incident. Apply there what is bothering you. And when you sort of see that When you remind yourself that there were feelings, perceptions, and you don't name people, you see dhamma, you see phenomena. That when you put at least some extent, how you just label it, you are just labeling like that. Label it so that to break the illusion. And when you do like that, it will follow. You will find immediate stresslessness. Like if you are worried about that thought, then you are activating fine part of your tranquility. So, and you must feel when you are reading and applying to yourself, your life, this should be done like that, this reading. So when you are walking, it takes about the present impermanence. So you immediately may be seeing the carpet. Just say it as perception feeling. Don't try to know what is perception feeling. You know perception feeling took place. Otherwise you can't perceive it as carpet, right? Like this, I hope you get an idea. Then you get, when it passed away, you see how it finished. You remind yourself. So slowly you activate. This is like a manual to study reality. To study this existence, this life, what we call. So going beyond imagination and illusion or fantasy about this life, we are getting knowledge. So we have to just apply to what is real and to think the way the Buddha wants you to think slowly. So it looks simple, but you learn that slow, simple thinking. It's important. And when you really do it very much, you will get a vision out of it. But that is later. Don't expect these things. Sometimes you might be interested to listen to us than the Buddha, the words read. Now, if you are not interested to read the book, sometimes means you are, because you know we are close in time with you. You understand? We are close, so we use all that. It immediately we feel an affinity to, you know, like we can relate and we can digest that. This looks so simple and like plain and repetitive and all that. Because our minds have come so weak. So I can't cheat you. I can't tell you, okay, you listen, you can understand. I might explain about consciousness so many ways. There are ways I must attempt it, but they are intellectually nice. It's not giving you that Arya knowledge, knowledge of the Aryans, the vision that puts you into the plane of no greed, no hate, no delusion. That state, that extent of experience. Quickly do, because we want to meet also, right? You know the very interesting look the Buddha, you know, he expressed. I discovered the profound truth so difficult to perceive, difficult to understand, tranquilizing and sublime, which is not to be gained by mere reasoning and is visible only to the wise. The world, however, is given to pleasure. Now he was reluctant as he had, delighted with pleasure and enchanted with pleasure. Truly such beings will hardly understand the law of conditionality, the dependent origination of everything. Incomprehensible to them will be also be the end of all formation, the forsaking of every substratum of rebirth. You see, the forsaking of every substratum of rebirth. Now he's not talking about the human rebirth, no? That's the interesting thing now. Someone might label him as a philosopher who doesn't know. He talks about the Devalokas, the Brahmalokas, their lifespans and how the idea of creation, all that comes. It's not just, you can't just, because it, without knowing the recorded, without the practice also, if you practice, you get to know it yourself. But substratum is talking about even, you know, the attachments you get to any feeling, even spiritually, to the meditation experiences. So even letting go of meditation finally, after it is well done, not before, like a ladder, you don't leave it up before you climb, use it. It is after you climb and then you let it go. So this is something, you know. The word, however, is given to actually reading like this. Makes me read also. The thing is, I should be reading again and again now this period. This is my practice. But now I have to come and give you all something. Because I have to polish my thing. Long time I've been neglecting this. This is very bad, can't help it. If my teacher was there, he was pressing me. But because I just enjoy on my own. Nobody check me. I'm teaching others. Nobody teach me. So I do my own thing. But of course, when I'm in real trouble, like, I don't know if you ever heard, I face attitude sickness and I really died. Actually, you go into a coma. And I faced this. This was the thing that made me decide to, because the last thought was I could share enough with the people. And then there's a focus, there's a practice which you do to face in case death comes. Now, this is daily time, so it becomes heavy. So, these are the things I couldn't share enough, you know, in a proper, more in a detailed way to the people. So that time there's a way of focus, you know, like so that's the one reason that I made up my mind to. So, but there are other practices I have to. So I know that the moment of death you should not have such thought. That means I have neglected something. Because many times I was thinking I must become an arahant to come. Okay, say you must be working for a PhD, but with your masters you can give something to the people. I mean, something like that. And with that experience, it told me that I should, you know, I had no interest to come to West or anywhere. Some other thing also I got to know. I mean, I would say this is like more psychically. Now I see this from Australia, first trip. That, you know, it convinced me that, told that though the countries, foreign countries are going, so that the people are dressed well and they're having good houses or vehicles and all this material comfort. But they are so thirsty for spiritual knowledge. You must go. And you know, just like sprinkling water to the arid. I can see this. I can see the drive. I can understand. Because, and I'm sure they can easily realize this truth than in the Sri Lanka or in all these places. Because they already have certain, they have no illusions about material life, and they are disillusioned by it now. and then that's quite a good situation to really appreciate this. But only problem in these places are like to have enough sense control, because there's bombardment of all the distractions, because they are all easily available. So there, if you know to be careful, this is super place, I think. To, if you have the right thinking and right literature and practice. I mean, even myself, when I was just walking, sometimes I see some lonely fields, just going walking like that, that would be a super place. If you are directed, if you are not, you will have all the negative things coming inside it. Sorry. And now the group of, you know, in this section, and what in brief is the five groups of existence: form, feeling, perception. Now, Panchupada Skanda Buddha says like this. Now, this one, okay. Let me just go now. If you read like this, for example, what now is the group of, now he's analyzing the four elements. We are here now. In the olden time, they have a way to sort of see it in terms of qualities. Now, hard nature and hard nature outside is same. Now we have now the electrons, and now it's further. It's a more sophisticated one. They also don't get an idea of person, right? I mean, if you see it, you are all electrons. That they say you don't get an idea. This is male, this is female, this person. This idea of person fades away. So to get that effect only, those days they put with the idea of elements. And uh, what now with the group of equations, you know? What now with the group of copper reality? It is the four primary elements. The form derived from them. Now with that, the form, whatever form that has come out, just stand there. And what are the four primary elements? They are the solid element, and the fluid element, the heating element, and the vibrating windy element, or movement. Okay? So you don't dwell too much on that. So you get a general idea. Now where to dwell and where not to dwell also is important. Now stories come, explanations come. You don't play, you know, this is the part to be meditated on. This is the part just to be read. Okay, you must have that sort of, otherwise you waste your energies on, and first you learn to relax, as I told you. First the sounds and keep relax, cool down and pay attention to the present moment. And what now is the solid element? The solid element may be one's own or it may be external. You have to get an idea. Now solidity, the nature of solidity could be outside and external. And what is one's own solid element? Whatever in one's own person or body, the exists of karmically acquired hardness, firmness, such as the hair of the head. Now there you have to get some picture, slightly. Karmically, now we know about Buddha's teaching, how these organs come, how they are formed, starting from the features when you're born, when the initially in the mother's womb, how the material part comes forming. It is due to pass karma. That karma is the force that materializes the base for consciousness, the body. So we have in our body parts, you know, exist karmically acquired hardness, firmness, such as the hair. Now what is predominant of that nature? We have the bones, for example, the hair. So Buddha goes in order, the hair of the head, hair of the body, nails, teeth. Now when he immediately says, they are like signposts for our thoughts, my friends. But this to contemplate, you need some tranquility. We are not focused on any memory, thoughts or running mind. When you are there, you can immediately just slightly visualize the hair, the nails, teeth, skin, flesh, sinews, bones, marrow, kidney, heart, liver, diaphragm, spleen, lungs, stomach, bowels, mesentery, excrement, and so on. This is called the one's own solid element. That means what is predominantly solid, which you call one's own because it's in this space. So that you get an idea of this is me. Now whether it be one's own solid element or whether it be the external solid element, they are both merely solid element. Now this is where you begin to sort of feel that this is a mental concept. Otherwise, now this mind, what holds the mind? This thing is also solid, okay? And the bone structure, wherever I hit the bone or teeth, or it's also hardness. This hard nature is same both ways. There you have to, when you're really calm, you feel the breathing process in you and the relaxing of the mind. With the relaxing, you should be able to not too much visualize as such. It is something I don't know how to explain. With the idea of letting go your body, you get the real picture. Just relaxing. Just hard, you have hard teeth. And the hardness of the ground or anywhere you tap. One should understand according to reality and true wisdom, this does not belong to me. This am I not, this is not myself. Those kidneys and all that. There's another way, they say that after 1 week or so you have an entirely new kidney or something, 2 weeks or something. Even the bone structure, I think after 2 months or 2 years, I don't know how long, but entirely a new one. All the old ones died. So with a silent is like, there's no you there. So you wait until you get the learn to apply like that. What now is the fluid element? The fluid element may be one's own or may be external. And what is one's own fluid element? Whatever is one's own person or body, there exists of karmic required liquidity or fluidity, such as bile, phlegm, pus, blood, sweat, fat, tears. You picture them slightly. That, like they are running, you know, with the liquid like form. So whether it be one's own fluid element or whether it be one's external fluid element, like you have a river or a tap, the water in there, and the blood in you, you get an idea because it's in that space, so you get that feeling is mine, like toilet, I mean like in urine also. When you urinate, it goes into the there you find it, it touches the water there, it becomes, you then get a feeling, this is not my urine. But when it's in that space, you get an idea, this is slightly you have to. So this exercise is normally this type of analyzing discourse is told when the monk has remained tranquil for a long period. Then he, and then he get these exercises are done in a certain degree. There are certain levels of understanding that comes up after that. But this is how it starts. You must read and just plainly what he wants to you to get the idea. You know, he wants to get the idea that there is a concept here and there is no real person. So at least when you can really focus like that, if someone shouts at you. When he tell me that the husband was shouting and they were able to see like this element and see there's another ear, another sound, and then he shout back. So even if you little bit read, even while you're driving, when you're coming, you see this memory will come and you try to exercise that. It's like a constant, you have to keep on sort of doing this to improve, to increase. This is another type, it activates wisdom. It makes you to really see there's no self. This self is a conceptual thing, you know, it's not something really exists as such. And then he goes to fluid element. Now whether it be one's own fluid element or whether it be the external fluid element, they are both merely the fluid element. And one should understand contrariety and true wisdom. This does not belong to me. This am I not. This not myself. He goes to all the other two elements and he says in the end, just as one calls a hut the circumscribed space that comes to be by means of wood and rushes, reeds and clay, even so we call body the circumscribed space that comes to be by means of bones and sinews and flesh and skin. These are to be felt slowly in the inner mind. It can be just one of this investigation that triggers this strongly. You see, it is your seeing, you're going to enjoy seeing the reality of you. This is another enjoyment. That is enjoyment. Reality means wisdom. You become lighter. If you had any ego or some heaviness from the ego, that baggage is slowly put aside. Even if you had some worries about the past, just rarely think of the past when you do these things. Past will become so unreal when you see the present also unreal. You understand? The present becomes unreal. What to say about the past? and in the future. You never existed and you're not, because now you're not existing. You never existed and you never exist. Something like this it will be. So I give you some idea. I will not go further because... Do you get some idea?
Yes.
Kamata, these are the kamata, meditation objects.
Yes.
But not, now the, my explanation part is not to be taken. Just take directly there. Certain type of wisdom will start to open in your brain. Those days it was completely, I was absorbed in this and my disco, my teaching was so different when I was a young boy. I was also talking a lot with people, but it was coming, the wisdom brain, like you know, your certain brain starts to work. You see deeply the final reality of everything, any subject. Don't try to polish it again because it has been unused for so many years now.
Amen. Thank you very, very much, Bhante, for that description. That was very enlightening. I would like to ask, what sort of sutra should we use in this context? Like,
I suggest this book because English translations are very good, you know.
Okay.
There's a big problem with the single translation. This is a big thing in Sri Lanka, big mistake. Old Sinhalese have been put into, you know, that. So, but there are, to overcome that, the Kilbakura Hamdo and Nadi Mahala, they have made other translations. So, if you are going through that, just get that, it's okay. But I don't recommend a single one completely because there are certain places they have tried to add them all that. It's not necessary, just keep it clean. Because there's something wrong with the translation also entirely. It is something we have to go, the map is there enough, good enough. With our practice, and there could be a single point where it will, you know, because this always directing you to that. And he's giving the simple, not to think too much, not to think. It's like in a middle way of something. It's a tuning thing is there. So it's very important to meditate a little bit and then read like that. Mix second to meditation is reading. I will guarantee. Yes, if you really pursue properly, you get something, you're beyond, finish. Your journey is finished from this. You see him, your dhamma pasati, summa pasati. You see means you have no doubt. There's nothing to see in him. You have but to see in emptiness. What's greatness is emptiness, not something infinite. Supreme emptiness from all. He's the one who really disappears from everything. And if you follow it, it will happen to you also. You know, if you attain samadhi, dhyan is the absence of the five senses. You disappear from this body then. But then you leave samadhi with wisdom. You disappear from a self. From ego. Not ego is not the one self. Even ego is the grosser, but even the idea of self, even the slightest idea of self, so that's the purity you find to reach from. They've not done anyone, you understand, I hope.
Bhante, I actually have kind of practiced not entirely what Bhante described now. But similarly, just like according to some instructions I have received before, so imagine something disgusting like cow dung or something like that, and then just look into it in terms of its properties, like it has some wetness, it has some hardness, and then compare it with the hardness and the wetness in the so-called your body, and then try to differentiate what is different, the wetness you find in here from the wetness you find in there. And when you try to differentiate, you actually see, well, there's nothing different. It is the same wetness in a different form, kind of a thing. I don't know if this is the right context to ask about this. It is kind of an experience that I've got when I was like trying to do this bit ambitiously. I feel like I feel like I'm scared.
No, when you properly now, when you do it, it will make you light. If you hold on, holding on to something, it makes you relax. So you have to see how, which way of thinking of that makes you immediately at peace.
Yeah.
You have to check your mind. What happened to now when I'm thinking like this? So you're not, you are waiting for a long time. Just immediately while you are doing it, you have to check whether you are getting more. So you start off with being ready to relax. Then it should increase your relaxedness.
Yeah. What I felt was completely kind of opposite. I don't know, something I was doing wrong. Or like I felt like I'm really scared and my heart rate is going up and I don't know what was happening to me.
You're frightened of the Buddha then, isn't it? Or maybe the demons, they don't want to leave, you know, they get a shock. Because we create a lot of, no, that's okay. But it's good if you can, like, it should be a word here echoing in you. Just what you read here must, you know, that not too much, you see, that it's not too much thinking also. You'll get a mental lightning. It's nice sometimes not in groups or anything, alone, walking. That's why I feel that if someone really wants this, I'm not expecting them to be like a long time guiding meditation, no. My teacher never, because I'm not interested to really guide you so much. If you are really interested to get liberated, this meeting is enough. You understand? I want such people, I mean, that they will, then alone they will do it and they will get it. With my teacher it was like that. We meet like, you know, just he will ask, then after 2 days, if I'm even there. And then we do on our own, because when you're on your own and sort of not feeling anyone is here, and when you're doing it only, there's something, this is it.
Yeah.
This thing can trip. And you should not try to go with, I want to understand, no plan, no nothing, you enjoy. Just reading, walking meditation a little bit. Then you want to listen to some, but it should be in that area, you know, like devotion or something. Think of the Bodhisattva how or something, okay, that. Then a little bit reading again, applying, and as long as you can do that. And there you see your brain will start to work and it will penetrate deeper, different levels of, it can be joy, there's another joy will be opening you.
Sometimes, Bhante, I also sort of become egoistic, like, oh, I'm like, oh yeah, this is it, I'm realizing it, like, this is coming to me, sort of, this, I'm becoming egoistic.
No, me is coming to me.
yeah, exactly. And I, is there any sort of instructions how to overcome that, like, to become humble?
No, you're so excited, you know, that you're so excited about being enlightened, that it makes you, like, you know, like you're meeting, I don't want to tell what it is, but it's okay. This is a good feeling. Don't worry, it is all right. And you learn to, yeah, some people, you know, they have so much, they respect and they like so much this teaching. They keep the books, you know, and they don't even read, open it. They put flowers and just keep it there. They're not frightened to open it. So it is, now is the time to taste it and really be it, to become that. Become that, and there, that's why I always say, now is the time should be walking stupas. How to know? When you are really experiencing that, you will not get angry. It will show very drastically, strongly in the society. You know, you look up, in other words, I tell, if you look mad among people, then you are sane, you know. In the society, you look mad, you are on the right path, you are on the path of saving yourself. But if you conform to them, you are going all together. So you should look like a meditating mad person. But really, when you're really this thing, you'll be like a walking mirror. People will begin to see their own, you don't have to teach, your very presence will be like a walking, it gives a reflection of what you, in the week, so that's the teaching, it awakens the person. Once I remember, you know, that one, my father, as a layperson, of course, but I was practicing. The car was parked one place, and one lady, you know, my father's gone out somewhere, and I was front seat. My lady came and just shouted, you know, in Bhagavata. Shouted and like something, she just shouted, why are you parking here, something, something like that, and left. No, no, not left. When she was shouting, I told her, sorry, auntie, my father, it will come, then he'll take the car out. And then she just shouted and then she came back again. Said, son, you can keep your car, but you didn't shout at me. He was telling, normally people, when I shout at them, they will shout at me. But you didn't shout at me, you know. And then, no, son, you can keep your car. Where are you from? And she started to ask. So this is something important, you know, where you cool, you become a mirror to the other world surrounding. That you don't have to do much things, that makes a big difference. What is the state of mind? And, so that's why even this should remove, change your state of mind. No point this all this, then you learn to apply to yourself and sort of bring it to see this and where you are holding on to something, that it is let go, that you. And there you experience tranquility to that extent of let go. And that tranquility will slowly, it's done very much, it will, you know, start to form in the aura and surround. Yeah, what doesn't allow you to let go, no point. That's why I say, better you go to a Muslim mosque or even a bar or something. I mean, Muslim is not bad. There are so many good things. I found even some Jataka stories are there. I happen to get to know now. Very interesting. Very interesting. You know Joseph, story of Joseph, because Yusuf, they call it. My goodness. You never heard, no? No, because we don't have any knowledge. We just sort of, you know, tell Muslim is, we only know Muslim is ISI. That is all. I mean, I am not a person because when you study and this thing, you find, my goodness, there were saints. You know, these are the stories of the Bodhisattva. No different, no less. How he was, the wisdom and the compassion he demonstrated in those births too. Now when you say like that, you begin to see, because now again, one want to feel Buddha is everything. That's also wrong. Now you, because your family is coming, better study, practice and see and test it in your daily life. Practicing any other thing which gave you practically to face a crisis situation and made you come out of it. And then use it, don't use any other thing but it. Anything else? Yeah, I know. Don't worry. We all will now awaken to it. I hope so. This is an Arya knowledge. Arya, you put this once for like knocking at the door. You must be one of them, you know, who are knockers. They call Gotrabhu. Gotrabhu in the vicinity of that sphere of enlightenment. Which you're always constantly thinking about it. Like it's a hard question you're thinking over and trying to apply and you're restless about it. Such a person will surely get some experience. This is the nature it should be, you know. Dhamma or Sari, they say. But you don't need all these titles. Anybody else want to, and before we go to anyone or to, you know, if you have some thing, okay? I don't know, back they are waiting patiently a long time. Okay, so shall we, what's the time now, by the way?
Quarter past 10.
Quarter past 10, we came at 8, no? So it's going equal to a program, isn't it? It's more than a program, I try to cut short it. This is what happens in Sri Lanka, me also. More I try to cut short it, because more and more. The only thing is, like, you know, I feel a little bit sad a bit when, because there are a lot of people waiting there to know what I'm doing, this chance of discussion and all that. I hope it is, you know, somehow shared to others.
Yes, amen.
But then I don't feel guilty. Because now I'm not, I can't sort of serve only one group or something. It has to be people all over where they are. And this is maybe, how, don't know how long it is, how life will go on. We can help many as possible for their mental peace and mental potential. There are many great souls. They should get the support. personally, some things you have, you wanted to get something. I also thought if you're coming tomorrow, also, tomorrow we can meet. Is it, how is it? Or would you be ready to meet me? Or tomorrow if you die or something? Some things you have, you really know if you do. I think you'll get answers, don't worry, have patience. Or would you like, for me, no problem, how is it?
It's better to do it today as well, tomorrow there are other set of people coming.
Is it?
Yes.
New people, is it?
Maybe it's big, yeah.
Okay. Maybe it's okay. Alright.